And Bishop started out saying, the glory is here. And it's been coming and hovering, and the cloud has come, the healing has come, and deliverance has come, and joy has come, and peace has come. Look at somebody and tell them, it's raining in here. Tell them, I can feel the rain. How many of you can feel the rain just raining in on the inside? Just feel the power of the rain. We just have a word from the Lord, and we want to share it with you, and we want to be able to give you what the Lord has given us, and we do want your prayers, because you know how it is when you've been all day, and I'm sure Pastor and Elder McClurkin and Brother Ron and them, you know, if you've been out all week long and using time and energy, sometimes it does things to your body, your voice, everything. So we strictly on the anointing, all right? Come on, go with us to the Word of God. In the book of Deuteronomy 32, will you turn with us? Deuteronomy 32, Mele Koryasa. And the book of Ephesians, chapter number 4. I'm honored to be here in this convocation with my pastor and our First Lady, Pastor Winans, and I'm so honored to be a part of this children's church and youth department that has just done an outstanding job in the Holy Ghost. I just love what they're doing and what they're representing. They're lifting Jesus. So all of the teenagers are not lost. And all of the teenagers and children are not confused. Thank God somebody's holding up Jesus at a young age. Can we say thank you, Lord? Ephesians 4 and verse number 26. If you have it, see, man. Now, verse number 26, just that one verse only. Can we read it together aloud? Come on, shall we? Be ye angry and sin not, and let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Shall we read it once again? Come on. Be ye angry and sin not, and let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Look at somebody and say, don't be mad. Just tell them again, don't do that. Don't do that. Be angry, but don't sin. Don't sin. Just talk to him for a couple minutes, just while you're turning back to Deuteronomy. Put your hand in and say, listen, don't do it like that, okay? Be angry, but don't sin. Don't say that. Don't do that. Be angry, but sin not. 32, the book of Deuteronomy 32 and verse number 48. If you have it, say amen. You're saying, Lou, you're getting a little weak, and I understand it, but come on up, church. Come on. If you got it, say amen. Because you love him, shout hallelujah. Come on, he's going to bless us. Verse 48 says, what? Shall we read it? And the Lord spake unto Moses and selfsame day, saying, get thee up into the mountain of Abram, unto Mount Nebo, which is in the land of Moab, that is over against Jericho. Behold, the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel for a possession. Verse 50, shall we? And die in the mount whither thou goest up, and be gathered unto the people, as Aaron thy brother died in Mount Hor, and was gathered unto his people. 51, because ye trespassed against me among the children of Israel at the waters of Meribah Kadesh, in the wilderness of Zin, because you sanctified me not in the midst of the children of Israel. Verse 52 in conclusion, yet thou shalt see the land before thee, but thou shalt not go up thither unto the land which I give the children of Israel. And let's just look at verse number 50 once again. And die. Stop right there. Say it. And die. Go up into the mountain, and he told him, and die. It's kind of cold, isn't it? You go up in the mountain and just die because you trespass. Look at somebody again. Be ye angry. And don't you sin. Just tell them, don't sin. Don't say all that stuff that's in your mouth. Don't let everything come out your heart. Come on. Come on, look at them one more time. You're going to help somebody. Come on, minister, and tell them, be angry. Be angry. But don't sin. Just say, but don't, but wait, hold it. Don't say all that. Don't do all that. Come on. Don't say all that like that. Come on, get somebody and say, hey, you. Hey, God said, be angry, but don't sin. Don't sin. Come on, look at him again. Say, hey, wait. You know I know you. Be ye angry and sin not. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Come on, we'll understand it in a minute. Let's just give God some praise anyhow. Huh? Come on, because you love him, just give him some praise anyhow. Come on. Just hold on. Couple more seconds. Come on, let's give him some more praise because he's worthy. Just hold it, saints. Hold him. Hold up. Hold him up. Hold up. Hold up the name of the Lord. Hold him up. It's a wonderful Savior. This is something really that the Lord has done. And some things the Lord takes you through because he just can teach you things better. Some lessons, and I thought this was personally my lesson. And the Lord has me to share it, and you know, I'm feeling really personal about it. But he's saying, right now, okay? And how many of you know he knows how to talk to us? How many of you know he knows how to come right down Straight Street? How many of you know he can come front too? He's a wonderful, magnificent Savior, and we love him for that. I was a couple months ago in a conference, and a sister there was teaching, and she was talking about one incident about Moses, and it just triggered. You know how something just a word just hits your spirit, and you just go to weeping and crying, and God just starts talking and lays line on line and precept upon precept. Before you know it, you're broken, and you're confessing and repenting and rolling all over on the floor and saying, oh, God. It seems like it's revelatory. It opens up at a certain time. And when you find you, thank God, the Holy Ghost can find you. And when the Holy Spirit finds you, then healing begins. How many know that? How many ever been broken in 1,000 pieces and God came along at the right time to heal you? Woo, tell somebody, woo, ain't nothing like when God heal you. I tell you, because he doesn't leave scars. He doesn't leave scars. So it's be ye angry and don't sin. Angry. Yeah. Upset. Tell somebody, I have been upset. How many of you ever been mad? Now I have to put up, you know, I have to come down the way, you know. Upset. How many of you ever been upset? Mm-hmm. How many of you have just raised your voice? Me. I mean at the key of Z plus. Huh? At 4,000 decibels, if there's any such thing. But you cannot sin. Look at him one more time and say, be angry, but don't sin. Don't sin. Don't get upset, but don't. No. There is what the Bible calls a righteous indignation. There is an anger that hits a level where you can be indignant for the power of God because the Holy Spirit in you is offended. But when the Holy Spirit is offended, it's not like our anger. Because the only time there is righteous indignation is when it is that God sees sin. He sees it. And when he sees it, he sees perfectly. But it's not like our anger. Now, the Bible speaks about anger in this particular passage. Hebraically, it speaks of anger as God's nose swelling and God foaming at the mouth and frothing because he sees, and what he sees perfectly, without error, without any erroneousness. There's no gray area. What he sees, and what he knows. And the Bible speaks about his knowledge and his knowing that he can search the heart. And not only search it, he knows the intent of the heart. And another word that they use to describe it is he knows the continuity or the essence of your thought. Before you think it, God knows it. He has weighed it. He understands it perfectly without flaw. You know how sometimes we say a thing, but when we say a thing, the other person on the other end, because they don't know you, has the ability to interpret it the way they perceived, not because they know out of what essence it came out of, but because maybe several other things have a tendency to play a part on how we interpret language around us. It could have been a bad day, a good day. It could have been a tired day, a weary day. It could have been a day where we miss words and sentences, and we misjudge the continuity of the text or the texture. And sometimes we misjudge vocal inflection. If we would have just said it a little softer, we didn't mean nothing by saying it as hard as we meant it. It's just tired, just take it and go on about it. But it left injury, and anger began to swell. Now, what the Bible is saying here, every time God gets angry, he has a perfect right to, because he has judged perfectly. He has saw and weighed the continuity of an individual's heart, and he knows the intent. He knows the day. He knows the circumstances. He knows everything. So when he walks away judging it, he judges it perfectly. So look at somebody and say, when God judges you, he judges you without a flaw. Perfect, perfect. He's perfect in his judgment. Perfect. Perfect in his judgment. I mean perfect. Tell somebody now, baby, he knows you. He knows you. And he sure enough knows me. He's not making a mistake. You know how sometimes when we know people have caught us, then we try to cover. You know, Pastor, we say, what did you mean by that? We're caught. So then we go to lying, deceiving, scheming, trying to cover up because we know we have wounded somebody, and now we're trying to back out of a situation. You know how we use those kind of word schemes? What did you mean by that? Nothing. I didn't mean nothing by it. But God knows the continuity of our hearts. And when he's angry at sin. The Bible speaks about God being angry in Psalm 7:11. It says, God judges the righteous, and he's angry with the wicked every day. So he never makes a mistake about why he is angry, like we make a mistake. We can make a mistake about your day, or make a mistake because it's a personality quirk of ours. We just never like people to talk to us at a certain tone or a certain level. And some of us get angry at people because they call us too early in the morning. And it is not about what they're saying to us, it's just too early. Don't talk to me before 7 o'clock in the morning, you know. And we just automatically have pushed the button of anger because you shouldn't be talking to me. And automatically we just go off. But be ye angry. And this word angry here talks about somebody who is on the verge and is in the essence of just have loss. Sometimes a loss of memory is showing feelings of anger. It talks about a wild, strongly wild person out of normal condition. It talks about a wild man, wild feelings that are out of control and strong, vibrant feelings. These conditions for the anointed of the Lord, which is sitting close by you, they're anointed people all around you. And you yourself are anointed. But what is so prevalent about this scripture and what makes it so important is that because prophecy precedes your life, it can also cut off your future. Be ye angry, but don't sin. It can cut off your future. Now, I never saw this before. That's the reason why it made me weep and cry and repent quick, fast, and hurry and say, Lord, fix this thing in me. Do it right now. I mean, hey, I didn't come this long to lose it. I don't come to church to lose it. So every little thing that he shows, it's there to help us. Tell somebody, he's going to show us just for just a second. And then he's going to cover us back up. Now, here in the Bible, when we look at it, it means to provoke. This angry means to be enraged, to be wild, to be at a strong rage, to be out of control. And this is the reason why the Ephesian writer talks about anger. And the Lord began to speak to my heart very clearly and precisely about Moses. For some reason, the Lord kind of has a tendency to leave me a whole lot in the old covenant. So we can learn situations and different kinds of admonitions of the Lord. So tell somebody we have to take just a short journey, just a couple centuries backwards so that we can understand what the Lord is talking to us. Tell them, let's just go on a trip with me. I don't know, you don't have to buy a ticket. We can get there in a hurry. Just tell them, come on, let's go, will you? Says, look, can we just go? Just go with me just for a few minutes. And what we're going to do is we're just going to look at the life of somebody that the Lord told us to stop off and look at that. Well, is that all right, young people? We're going to look? I want you to see Moses as a young man brought up in the palace, and you know the biblical story, but we just want to brush over the history a little bit for you. Now, where we're stopping at is a time where we're looking at Ramesses in his son, Junior. We're looking at Ramesses II, and we're looking at the end of an Egyptian era, because we're looking at the close of a dynasty. Now, what is very unique about Egypt is that it had very strong dynasties. And what was very strong about Egypt and Ethiopia and a lot of the African things that came up out of the land was that they were very strong in what they believed in as far as deities. The only confusion is that often they served the wrong god. It wasn't that they were not worshipers, but they were worshiping the wrong thing. So these people always had an act or a desire or a focus to worship something. That is the reason why, even on this particular day that we live in the 90s, that people wonder why that our particular culture is so excitable when it comes to God. Why don't we just be comfortable when we worship? But we're kind of come from that kind of background where it's easy for us to gravitate to worship, and I'm glad about that. I'm glad we might have in the past here and there gotten mixed up on who to worship, but somebody just lead us to the right one to worship. And this is can be a very worshipful people, but in this particular time it is a dark, black, bleak era. We are around somewhere between the 18th and the 25th dynasty, and we're looking at people who don't understand who God really is. You're looking at a dynasty of Egyptian rulers who had even sometimes queens on the throne, who didn't have a particular problem about women or men being in control. It was just who was in line next to rule. And at this particular time, we're at Ramesses II, and we're seeing his daughter. If you notice the particular thing that makes Moses such a key focus here, my young sisters and brothers in Christ Jesus, is that you notice the frenzy is about a son. The daughter doesn't have a son, but Moses becomes that son. You don't hear anymore about any of the other sons. The daughter brings in the son, and when we look at Egyptian culture at that time, and this is the reason why Moses becomes so important, because it appears that his daughter in this particular time could not bear children, and she herself was barren. For this reason, she takes a particular focus on Pharaoh. Notice that her dad there needs a son. You always need an heir, and she wants to give him a child. Isn't it unique how God will prep your future so that where doors would be closed to you, he has already prepped the future for you to get in? You are not the likely to succeed. You're really the least likely, but he will prep your future and put you where you need to be, regardless to the color of your skin, your educational background, your inabilities, or your capabilities. God will prep your future because he has already ordered your steps. Now, the child doesn't know that the future has been prepared. So at the right time, she's bathing. And of course, we know at this particular time, children were such great blessings. And the wealth of a woman was known by how she carried the child. Now watch. In old culture, the father is very important. Tell somebody, daddies are important. whether they are leastly esteemed today or are taken lightly, I want you to know fathers are very important. Tell them again, fathers are very important. Fathers are important. Why? Because the father has the ability to place name. He has the ability to foster name and character. Now watch it. The name means something. Now notice, now mothers are also important. Tell them to say mothers also are quite important on this journey. So we're going to look at them. Tell them mothers are important because they are thought to be the succors. They are the soft, the comforters, the ones that you run to and cry, the ones that you can lay in their bosoms. But fathers bring name identification. Fathers bring dignity. And you have to watch us. Now, the reason why this is so important is because family unit is very important. Regardless of what the devil's trying to do against family, God started out with a family, and believe this, we're going to go out of family. Regardless to all of the stigmas and regardless to all of the things that are coming against the family, God started out with one, and he's going to end up with a family. He said he's coming back for his children. He's going to be a father, and he's coming back for his children. Now notice, he could have just been God, but no. He said, when you talk to me, talk to me. I'm your father. Say, our father. So the fatherhood of God, why? Is because the name is carried in fatherhood. Now I want you to carry my name. Watch it. It gives dignity and it symbolizes honor and stature. It takes a place in the families of God and in the humane families of all of the Homo sapiens here that have lived upon the earth. Notice fatherhood is very important. Why? We've been taught, even by our own doctor, Claudette Copeland, says it like this. She says, because of the name that the father carries, even in the community, you're not known by your name, you're known by your daddy's name. And they expect you to take on the characteristics of the man who carried the name. So the name is very important. Tell him your daddy's name is very important. Now, even in our generation, notice when we were coming up a couple days ago, as these young teenagers are coming up now, remember when a girl got messed up? All they would want to know is, what name is the baby going to carry? What name is she going to have? Is she going to give him? Is the man willing to give the boy the name? Because the boy is not considered a particular validated man child unless the daddy was willing to give up his name. The name was important. It's important in society what name you carry. Therefore, a lot of times when you get in trouble, they'll ask you, aren't you Willie James's daddy? And not your daddy. Isn't Willie James your daddy? You look just like him. I'm going to tell him what you're doing. You can't escape in the community that we used to come out of because you look like your daddy. You carried your daddy's name. And they knew what your daddy stood for. So they knew that the power was behind your daddy's name. And the mother was the one that secured, the one that comforted, the one that gave you what you needed so that you could understand how to be soft and how to be able to understand it's all right to cry, but come on, you can make it. She was the encourager, but the father validated you. And you need that validation. And many of us may not know who our fathers are, but thank God, since you've come into this holy family, you're still not without a father. You've got somebody that's validating you, somebody that is telling you, you're not just out there hanging. You belong to me. You are owned. You are possessed. I give you my name. I validate you. I'm not ashamed of you. Here, take my name. Come on, put your hands together and give God praise. What's important here then? Pharaoh has no son to give his name to. And the next heir could, by that particular era or dynasty, could have been his daughter, and she could have been the next queen upon the throne, but she wanted her father to have a son. So the daughter could give the son as an heir, the grandson of her daddy's was a king, so she could give the heir. Now, Moses was nurtured to be the heir. He was to be validated. Ramesses took on Moses and validated him as a son. He gave him authenticity. He gave him authority and power. He allowed him to enter into schools. You understand? See, he could go through the palace. He could go into situations and places that normally by color he and by skin texture, even by language barriers, he should not have been able to excel to. But God had already prepared his future by validating him among men, by giving him a name that was above every name in the earth. And that high name where he lived was Ramesses. So he carried the name, and it became a door opener, and it's let him be in top colleges and classes and things of that nature. You see, the young teenager Moses is having a ball, sliding up on down the floors, granite floors, and sitting down and eating at the table with beautiful napkins, servants at his beckoning call. Anytime he wants to eat, he can. He's being groomed for kingly work, kingly heirship, kingly control. He's being groomed to rule a world, not only his known world, but to subjugate worlds around him. Look what God is preparing. God will open doors for you that you yourself have not even dreamed of. And you think you are just going to school, young people. And he'll put you around people and put people in front of you that you don't even know. They're putting their hands on you, and they're making your heart pliable. They're teaching you things. They're pouring into you. You don't even know. Your destiny is being groomed, and you're being groomed for your destiny. And you're going to be what God has scribed for you to be. This young man at this teenage age is just having fun, like most of our teenagers, but they're pouring into him and grooming him for greatness. He doesn't even know how great the task is, because God does not bother children with masterful plans when they're just children. He only grooms them and causes them to be put in the hands of molders. He makes sure they're in the hands of governors and gives them the ability to be mentored by those that need to pour off in them, sets them at tables where at the right time with the right folk. A lot of this pastor didn't probably even dream he'd ever be, but he was sitting at the right table at breakfast one day, and people were pouring off into him, and he didn't even know why it cleaved in his spirit. You don't know why you hold on to things, Brother Donnie. You don't know why you talk like an old man, but you were being groomed before your time. Because God mentors you for your destiny ahead. He starts real young, real early. And sometimes he displaces you. He picks you up out of one familiar circumstances and drops you as if it was in another. But it's really not a drop to him, but it is a designed, specified place. Because your molding must continue. Your grooming has to be done, and you must be mentored and tempered right. And he sets the right amount of trials around you just to temper you, because see, God doesn't want silver. He's looking for gold. He's looking for gold, and gold has to be tempered at a certain amount of heat, and it's got to be at a level until the dirt comes up to the top, and at a temperature where the gold melts and becomes agile and will take on the form of anything it's poured into. God will turn up the heat in your life until there's no more dirt, till they just take it and skim it off the top and pour you into situations, and you don't know why you coagulate, and you don't know why you're agile, and you don't know why you're being mushed and molded and pushed around. But look at somebody and tell them, God just making me for my future. God's just making me. So this young man Moses is being made, and there in the mentorship also is his mother to keep him culturally aware about his history. He must know where he came from. He must not be around here aimlessly disjointed, unaware of his spiritual heritage. He can learn these natural things and understand these natural educators, but he must also be culturally aware. He must understand where his forefathers have come from, what his ancestry is about. The only thing that just really rips our hearts in this present day is the Negro man and woman very fragrantly does not know where they come from. Because it is abstract in schools. It's not available too much in libraries. It's not mandatory education. It ought to be mandatory, just like reading, writing, arithmetic. Every man, woman, boy, and girl ought to know where his ancestors derived from. And it ought not be a slanderous look down because of the color of man's skin. It ought to just be even Stephen. I don't like it because of a personal thing, but here is your history. Here's your culture. Here's the original flag. These things are important because it validates, it connects you, it causes you to belong. When you are displaced, you feel like there's no ownership, there's no pride. Displacement is for that reason. It is to deduce you to nothing, to bring you to the opportunity of not having pride to be able to hold on to anything. But thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. Well, this young man has his spiritual continuity of his background, his culture, his history being read to him, the God of their fathers being taught to him at the lap of his mother, the Sakura, the one who comforts his ills and tells him, son, you're being groomed for greatness. You don't understand it, but you're being groomed. You don't know why, but you're being groomed. But the son, follow the steps. And you see this young man growing, and he feels the time is coming. It's clear. It's clear. God is giving visions and dreams. And young people, God will give you dreams and visions. You're not too young for dreams and visions. God will give you dreams about what he's going to use you to be. He'll give you visions. He'll wake you up in the night. He'll shake you and you can't sleep. Just don't think it's about a bellyache and I just lost sleep. God's trying to get your attention. Just roll on out the bed and hit your knees and start saying, here am I, Lord. Sometimes because of the busyness or the frustration of your little day, a lot of homework, a lot of housework, a lot of store and back and forth, and a lot of little personal peer problems, you feel like you just can't sleep. No. Get on your knees and just talk to God and watch God show you special things that he's earmarked for your future. You're not just an aimless youth, a good for nothing youth. God uses absolutely every young person. Our Bible is just laced with youth that is used under the auspices of a control of the hand of a mighty God. You're not too young to lay hands on the sick and they recover. You're not too young to speak in unknown tongues. You're not too young to preach the gospel. Not too young to bring souls out of darkness. God's going to use some of these young people mightily. Reach up and tell God, yes, Lord. Come on, let's throw our hands up and tell him, yes, Lord. Well, this young man, it's time now, and he's around the ages of 20, and being groomed well, he hits 30, and the visions are still coming, and because of the rapidity of the visions, he feels like the time is moving closely. Sometimes your vision is for tomorrow, not tomorrow, 24-hour tomorrow, but God's tomorrow, which sometimes can be years in the distance. You have to, when you get the vision, ask God when. Never just accept it like that and think it's tomorrow, 24 hours later. Ask God for when. And if God doesn't say now, then hold it in your heart. That means in the future. He's going to tell you a little bit more clearly about how he's going to use you. Now this Moses is around about 40 and it's time to do the job. But we see him rambunctiously, anxiously, willing to fulfill God's will for his life. How many of you had a vision and you just felt like it's time, God, and you're just excited and you just start running and said, Lord, just use me. How many of you just throw up your hands and just know how excited you were and you wanted God to use you? And God said, not yet, not yet, not yet. And because of the delay, it brought frustration. But this young man, Moses, sees that the time is now. He feels like it's now. It's just got to be now. This anointing on me is so strong. This burden that God has called me to be a deliverer for my people. He had the focus just a little off. He thought in the realms in which he was taught that he was being groomed for national deliverance and a deliverance that would take forth through the forces that men use, like the strengths of laws and governments and guns and bombs and insurrections and hand-to-hand combat. These are natural weapons. He just completely outruled God intervening in another kind of way. He never thought God was going to use spirit kinds of things, mystical kinds of weaponry. He thought it was going to be natural warfare. An eye for an eye, toe for a toe. You kill us, we kill you. It's war. No. God does not fight like that. He fights on a higher plane, a higher level. So now Moses runs out and sees the atrocities done to his brother. Ain't no need in getting upset with him. We got upset when Rodney King was brutally beat and we saw it. Did something down in your spirit. It just broke your spirit, broke your heart to see him take blow after blow after blow. Well, sitting on the sideline, the same thing happened to Moses. He saw him beat the man down unmercifully, saw him under the hand of the taskmaster being whipped down with no defense covering, and the anger rose up in him, and the anger moved him forward. Be angry, but sin not. He could have just stood on the lines and just got angry and told God, no, we can't take this like this no more. He could have been angry and propelled into fasting. Hit his knees and tell God, you've got to come and do something. And do something quick, fast, and in a hurry. The anger to be utilized the proper way is to take it and run to God with it. And let the hot tears run down your face and start praying to God, and before you know it, you'll hear the scripture say the effectual. That effectual means that hot, boiling, I'm upset. This devil can't keep doing this to me. I'm sick of being here at the same place, at the same incident, the same mountain. It got to move. It's got to get up out my way. That effectual fervent. Use anger as a tool to whip the devil down. Use anger in the right way. Channel the anger. Channel it in the right way. Use it to whip that devil down. Use it on your knees and tell God, I'm sick of the devil fighting in my family. I'm sick of the devil destroying our young people. I'm sick of this devil. In the name of the Lord Jesus, do something. But instead, he took his anger in the wrong channel. He allowed his anger to use him. And the anger told him, kill him. Kill him. And he picked the man up and killed the man and then buried the man. Now, the thing about anger is, anger only comes when there are wounds or when someone feels abused. Anger only happens when there are hurts or wounds or abuse. abuses. Anger only comes when someone feels abused or hurt. Or anger only comes when someone feels wounded. Anger only becomes the flower, but at the root of anger is wounds and hurt, and it can turn into bitterness, and the bitterness can feed the anger. Anger is not the root of the tree. Anger is the flower. You have to go down under the ground and see what was at the roots. Hurts is the mother, and abuse is the father, and out comes the spring of that life. The flower is all we see, but down under the ground, hidden away in the heart somewhere, somebody's been wounded and somebody's been hurt. And that's why when you came along that day, they said, no, I've been down this road before, and I promise a few responsible people I'll never let another one take me down here. You're gonna have to get up off of me. Come on, shout hallelujah. Anger, be angry, but don't sin. So Moses sinned, and he hid the body in the ground, and he's hurt. That's the only reason why he was angry, abuse after abuse. Now he runs and he hides and feels like he's done well with it, because he's not dealt with this kind of conflict anymore. Because you hide and suppress your anger does not mean you're dealing with it. I told you anger is only the flower, but hurts and abuse are the seed of anger. Because of constant things that have hindered you, and you can't seem to get through the barriers. That's the reason why we get angry. When you've been blocked and blocked and blocked and blocked, and somebody tells you you're not getting through here, it changes your attitude. You become hurt, and all of a sudden you push, but this time you're angry. My sister and brother, he hid on the backside of the mountain, but that wouldn't mean he was dealing with it. Tell somebody next to you, you got to deal with that thing. You can't keep carrying that stuff around. You've got to deal with it. Look at him again. Say, you've got to deal with it. Because just suppressing hurt does not mean you dealt with it. And when you don't deal with it, it comes up at the most inopportune time. When you don't deal with yesterday's hurts, that does not mean, because you've not thought about it for 4 months, that you've handled it and that it's gone away. Your brain has a unique mechanism whereby which it will make sure it is hidden from your view. Because when I show you this, you cry. And when I show this to you, you get upset. And I'll just keep it over here. And as long as you don't see it, then you'll be all right. But that's not dealing with the issues. The Bible tells us that we have to endure hardness sometimes. Some days you've got to just go before God and tell him, get this junk out of me. I'm not going to keep this. And let it come up at the wrong time. Now, 40 years late down the line, Moses comes up again, and God starts to use him all over. Sends him back down to Egypt and tells him how he's going to fight. The weapons of your warfare are not going to be carnal, but yet mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. I'm going to use spiritual weaponry, Moses. Put your hand in your bosom. Pull it out. Look at it. It's leprous. Show that to them and they will believe. Now, but if they don't, throw down the rod. He threw it down. It turned into a serpent. He said, catch it by the tail. And it became a rod again. He said, if and they don't believe the first time, surely they will believe the second sign. He hasn't dealt with that thing though, but he's walking with God. He's preaching, he's ministering, he's prophesying, he's encouraging the people, but he hadn't dealt with that thing yet. He's walking them through the Red Sea. They're going over the bottom of the sea on dry ground, and when they get to the other side, they're having a revival. When they get on the other side, the tamarinds go to ringing, and Miriam leads out the praise dancers. Bible said the women beat the tamarinds, begin to dance. They sing and dance. Pharaoh's army got drowning in the Red Sea. Moses said, hey, y'all look here. This enemy that you have seen, you will not see him ever again. Somebody look at somebody and tell them happy days are here again. They were happy all over again. They entered into the wilderness, and God helped them there. And as they walked, they were fed by day. And by day, they were fed manna. And in the evening, they sat around and felt the fire of the manifestation of God by night. The fire at night was the theophany of God showing them that I'm with you and will never leave you. In the day became a shielding cloud. That cloud was a banner. They call it a Bangladesh. It was a banner that kept them from the heat. It was a waste howling wilderness, so they could understand that God would never leave or forsake them, because he was a Father. He was validating his name in his children. That name was going to go down in them, and they were going to understand a fatherhood. He was going to be the provider that validates you. He was going to be the one that supplied, that validates children. He was going to be their protector. That's what a father does. He stands between you and the enemy. That validates you, makes you feel secure, makes you feel safe. He was going to provide their every need. That gives you security in your daddy, because daddy always has. Can I have an ice cream cone? Yeah, baby. Can I ride on your back, daddy? Yeah. Can I walk with you, daddy? Yeah. I'm hungry, daddy. Here's some bread, son. That validates you, makes you feel cared for, wanted. It makes you feel secure. And daddy, I'm what? What about tomorrow? Don't worry. Daddy's got that under control. I'm taking care of it. You just go on outside now. Go on and play, and leave daddy to the business of living. Oh, child of God, they didn't have to worry about a thing, because daddy was there. When they cried, he answered. When they got weary, he gave them water to drink. When they were hungry, he fed them. When enemies came, he protected them. Somebody said, I got a good daddy. Shout hallelujah in the house. But my sisters and brothers, as fast as children will do, there was civil rivalry. Sibling rivalry started to happen. And Moses seemed to take the brunt in, because he was daddy's leader. He was the one God was going to use. So they picked on the elders. They picked on God's son there. They picked on Moses. And they told him, listen, and straighten this stuff out. We're going back into Egypt. And Moses took that pain, kept on going. And later on, they said, this time we're going to kill you and Aaron. Moses took that abuse, but kept on going. He kept crying, asking God, work this out, work that out, work the other out. They cry for bread, and Moses would tell them, listen, he's a faithful God. He's never failed you. They cry for sweet water. Cry because the water was bitter, and Moses would cry to daddy, and daddy tell him, cut down the tree, and the bitter water turned sweet, and they cried for meat, sick of the bread, and then he cried to daddy, dad, oh father, they just tired of eating this bread, can you send them some meat? And daddy would send meat, fresh meat, close enough so they could contain it, my sister and brother. But they don't know, they keep offending this man. The hurt is still there, the wounds are still there. You can be wounded right in the house of the Lord. The saints can wound you. Watch it now. You're over here, but you're over here because God brought you. But keep your heart on God, because the enemy is the thief. He'll come to steal, kill, and destroy, and give you another spirit. Yes, he will. He'll wound you to the point you don't want to serve. He'll wound you till you want to stay home. He'll wound you till you say, I just can't take it any longer. He'll wound you till you say, is it worth it? He'll wound you till you can't sleep at night. He'll wound you. But I'm here to let you know that God can heal every wound. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. If you know what I'm talking about, shout hallelujah. Moses, deal with it, son. They wounded the man so. Until now, heck, glory. Look at him. He don't know what to do. His wife is contemplating leaving. She can't seem to understand the doctrine, the strangeness of it, the cruelty of the ministry. The hair seems to toss her to and fro. And remember, Moses understands the hurt of it, but they don't understand his hurt. My sister and brother, people will wound your family members right in the house of God. If they can't get to you, they'll get to your children. If they can't get to you, they'll get to your husband. If they can't get to the husband, they'll get to the wife. Reach over and tell somebody, you be angry, but don't you sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. People get upset. Oh, child of God, everybody in the house of God doesn't have the victory yet. It's not that we're all not going in the right way, but we have not all grown into some things yet. And we're all on different levels, and because we sit together sometimes, we take for granted that we're all on the same spiritual wavelength and the same spiritual understanding. But shake your head and say, not so. You could be sitting right beside a real baby, somebody spoiled and cantankerous, somebody that's powerful and fretful, somebody that would give up at a drop of the hat. You got to know who you making your traveling buddy right here in the house of God, because everybody you traveling with don't have a mind to hold on. You got to make sure that who you traveling with, when you hit the floor, they say, hold on, don't give up now. Get up from here. God hadn't changed from being God. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Put your hands together and give him the praise. My God, my God. Moses, Jesus is wounded, doesn't know what to do with that thing. It's a pile-on thing sometimes. It's one hurt after the other, and it opens up old hurts. And you can't seem to deal with it. Look here. And because he cannot deal with it, Bible says anger resteth in the bosom of a fool. Doesn't mean you don't have sense enough to know you're doing wrong, but you know what you're doing, but you too stupid to do the right thing. What makes us stupid? Pride makes us stupid. I'm not going to let you get the best of me. I didn't get a chance to get my word in edgewise. You're not going to talk to me like that. Wait a minute, I'm 7 times 7 plus, and I got a little something I got to say to you. You put your hands on your hips, and you say, no, 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 I've been not taking that from nobody. Yeah, I got something for you. Just hold on, let me tell you what it is. Don't go nowhere. I feel it coming on now. My sister and brother, be angry, but don't just sin. Keep your mouth shut. Keep your tongue still. Keep your thoughts to yourself, and tell God, help me. Quick, fast, and in a hurry. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Shout glory. Put your hands together and give him the praise. Hallelujah. Good God from Zion. Oh, my brother, deal with it. So he goes on wounded and goes ahead hurt here. And my Lord, my God, seems like he be deal with it, Moses. But she leaves. But the father brings him back and stands outside the camp. Thank God for good fathers. Stands outside the camp with the sons and the wife and says, listen, come get your children. Come get your wife. We're out here. And he goes and gets his wife and his sons, kisses his father, kisses, embraces him, bows down and invites him in and explains some things. And because of it, God gives him revelation. And now he understands phase two of his ministry. Phase two is he disciples down and devise anointings and powers for the longevity of the ministry. He divides into 70 elders under him, disseminating before the growth sake of the ministry. My sister and brother, what we gonna do with Moses? He's getting revelations and preaching and teaching and leading people. Reach around and say, you leading folk. But be careful, be careful, be careful. Listen here now, Pastor. Watch now. Because sometimes we feel like we're exclusive. Sometimes you preach and teach and you forget about you. You sit down and you hear the word, you hear the word, you hear the word. And you've forgotten to deal with some things yourself. Number one here. And God has to pull your strings and say, wait now. You going to deal with this? And you hold on one minute. I don't want to show that yet, because every time I show that, I can't handle it. I cry. I weep. I can't stand all the emotion. This thing is hurting me too bad. I don't know how to even address it to you. Sometimes, if you know what I'm talking about, sometimes you can be wounded so, feel so mentally disenchanted, so physically and mentally disoriented, till you don't even know how to phrase your words before God. You just leave there. Discombobulate it and just say whatever you got to do, just do it. because you know, you know, you know what you know about me, and I need your help in this. So here, my sister and brother, Moses is not dealing with the issue yet, but it does not defeat the fact that God deals with him. They keep on walking through this desert, over mountains, defeating enemies, climbing over valleys, running through troops, and miracles are being wrought, but he's not dealing with the issue. Look at somebody and say, deal with it, deal with it, deal with it. Hallelujah. Because he won't deal with it, then things begin to happen. The time when he really needed to be on top, all this stuff hit at the same time and blew him mentally and spiritually out the water. Watch. The Bible says, make no friends with an angry man. Why? Lest you follow his ways and you be wounded in your soul. Bible said, make no friends with an angry man, why, Lord? Lest you follow his ways and end up being snared in your soul. You can't follow folk. Always got a hot temper and don't never forgive nobody and hold their mad for years and hold grudge after month and don't never forgive anybody cause it's resting in the bosom of a fool and any moment now it's going to explode just like Mount Everest and it's going to be a snare to the soul. Now that word snare means to trespass against God, to sin and lose hope for the future. Oh no, ain't nobody worth that. Traveling with folk in the church that really snare your soul so that you miss your hope for the future. Ain't nobody worth that. Singing with them, honey, but don't befriend them. Shout with them, but don't befriend them. Usher with them, but don't. God said, don't make them your buddy, cause they're gonna be a snare to your soul. You just got to live this thing the way the Bible said, cause God knows that at the root of anger, anger is only a flower, but at the root of anger is a broken, hurt individual, and people will minister, but they're hurt. They'll sing, but they're hurt. They'll walk around the church and paste a phony smile on their face, but they're hurt. And they got to learn to deal with it. In church, we learn how sometimes to be hypocrites. We'll tell people we're doing fine when we're lying all the time. We can barely make it through the next journey, but our pride won't let us tell you. I'm wounded beyond repair. I don't know if I can make it another day. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to take this thing. I'm working with it, but it look like it's working me. I'm rolling with it, but it look like it's rolling me. I'm trying to stand on it, but right now it's standing on top of me. Hallelujah. You got to learn how to ask God, help me here. You got to get on your knees and pray and keep asking God, help me deal with this thing. Get this junk out my heart, cause I can't take it any longer. I'm not gonna be fake and not gonna be abnormally low. I'm not gonna be no hypocrite. I'm not making it. Come on, shout hallelujah. So Moses wouldn't deal with it. So when it got tough and they talked bad at him the last time, wasn't nothing out of the usual. They always dogged him. They always ran him down. Wasn't nothing out of the usual. But sis, it was just at the breaking point. Wasn't no new statement. No we knew way they said it. They always ran him down. Always misused him. Always lost respect for God's man. But wasn't nothing unusual about this day. It was the same old attitude. But he snapped. He broke. But when he broke wrong. When he got up this time from prayer, he uses a different dialogue. He says, on his way down in the valley of Kadesh Meribah, he stands there and says, do we have to give you rebels some water? When's the last time somebody voted you God? You didn't give me the first cut. You didn't give me the first piece of bread. There's a mixed Christian identity. He moves into pseudo Christology. He takes on the form of God. Steps down and tells them, you rebels. When you say you rebels, that takes on the continuity of knowing the individual's heart. Now they may have been stiff-necked, unlearned, difficult to follow spiritual things, but they were not rebels in the eyes of God. You're not a rebel till God calls you a rebel. Listen here. He took on the godness of identifying the continuity of an individual's heart. God said the heart is desperately wicked above all things. You can't know it. I'm the only one that knows the heart. You this, that, or the other, but it's only a name, honey, because you really don't know me. You don't know me like he knows me. He knows me like you don't know me. That's only what you see on the outside, but God knows the heart. Shout hallelujah! Shout hallelujah! Shout hallelujah! Oh, glory! Put your hands together and give him the praise. Here. This man Moses says, do we, taking on Godship, have to give you rebels, taking on the continuity of God? I know your heart. Do we have to give you water, taking on the identification of a father? He was not their father. He was just a servant. He moved out of place. God said, you've transgressed. Now there are seven words for transgression. This word transgression here means you knowingly knew what you were doing and step over the bounds. That means someone who is aware of their sin and steps over anyway. That means something has to push you. When you know you're getting ready to do wrong and can't stop but gonna do it anyway. I'm not gonna hold this. That's something pushing you from your past. I'm not taking this muff off you today. That's words from the past. That's wounds that jump up in your spirit from the past and tells you, not today. I'm not taking this junk off of nobody. When you say nobody, you've lined up your past and say, I've taken it there, but not here. Come on, shout hallelujah. Listen, Moses transgressed. And the Bible said knowingly that it was sin. Transgressed, stepped over and said, no, don't keep me back. Holy Ghost, I'm saying this. I'm going to say this. I'm going to say this out of my mouth. So here it is, you rebels. Do we have to give you water? And when he smote the rock twice, when he was just supposed to speak to it, in other words, he took on the form of the will of man. I'm going to do it my way. That's the spirit of Cain. I'm going to do it my way. I'm going to beat this rock. But he didn't smote it with any kind of gentleness out of anger. He hit the rock
The Bible says that rock was Christ Jesus. Now listen here. Immediately God, now watch it. God judged him and put him out and told him, go up in the mountain and die. Watch it here. Your life is filled with prophecy, but that does not mean you will fulfill your own destiny, because you can be angry and cut your future right off. He didn't look at God. He said, why, God, give me another chance? He said, no, you transgress. That was not just one time. Look at me, he wouldn't deal with it. He kept holding that junk. He kept holding on to that past. He kept holding on to those abuses. He kept holding on to them hurts from the saints. If you get wounded in the house of God, drop that stuff. As fast as it comes in, drop it. God said, I wanna listen. I got future plan for you. Drop it. I don't care what they say, drop it. I don't care what they think, drop it. I don't care what they do, drop it. I got a future plan for you, but you got to make up your mind. Do you want to be in it? I said, oh, whatever you do, take this junk out of me. Hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. So say yeah, say yeah, say yeah, hey, 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 hey. Put your hands together and give him the praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I want my future. Look at somebody and tell them, I want what's mine. I want my future. And I'm not letting no devil in hell cut me off. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. So say yeah. So say yeah. 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 Put your hands together and give him the praise. Tell the devil, I'm not going to let you cut me off. I'm not going to let you cut me off. I'm going to do what the Lord called me to do. So I'm say yeah. 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 Put your hands together and give him the praise. Hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hurt. Hurt can cripple you and cut you off. Because there comes a time, thanks. There comes a time God gives you to deal with that. And when he gives you that grace, that covering, he said, now dump that stuff out. I won't let them see it. Just dump it out. Go on, cry, but cry. I'll cover you till you finish crying. And when you finish, dry your eyes. Come on, endure hardness as a good soldier. Come on, let's fight the good fight of faith. Let's lay hold on eternal life. Come on, yeah, yeah. Moses, notice the book closes. God says, go up and die. That's cold. That's not one time, Angie. God don't cut you off for one time. That's somebody holding stuff. Holding the wound deal. Old pains, old wounds. Many of us have old wounds of parents that hurt us. Fathers that violated us. Mothers that abused us, but we won't deal with the pain. We won't deal with the hurt. We won't deal with the pain. We won't deal with the words they called us, the things they abused us with. My sister and brother, you got to deal with that. Yeah, you saved. But it'll cut your future off. Notice Joshua 1 verse 1. He said, now my servant Moses is dead. Cut off. He started off. His job was to lead him into the promised land. Cut
off. Don't tell me you will start with God, but you won't end. Now listen, your spirit can cut you off. Wasn't that there was no vision for you, no direction for you, no promise for you, no anointing for you, but you wouldn't deal with you. He was cut off. Watch the next word. And as I was with Moses, so will I be with you. Oh, yeah. You can preach, sing, do all of that. You got to deal with that junk in your heart. Deal with it. Because it turns you into bitterness and it turns you into hypocrisy. Hypocrisy means hypo, abnormally low. That means you're lower than normal folk, just low. Because why? You're living a lie. Hypocrisy means people who act a lie knowingly. Act it knowingly. You have to put that on. And at home, you take it off. It means professional actors and actresses. Right in the house of God, just walking in a lie. Parade in lies. Pretending to be what you know. See, hypocrisy doesn't mean you falsely do not know. It means you pretend, but you know the real you. But you pretend to seduce others to believe you to be what you know yourself not to be. And the Bible says, a liar will not tarry. So yeah, you preach, you sing, you jump, you holler. But who are you really? The Bible says, be ye angry, but sin not, because it'll wound your soul. It will wound you in your soul. So regardless of what happened, yeah, we all say, and we all make 1,001 mistakes, and I'm at the top of the ladder. You make 50 million mistakes in a day, but you got to know how to deal with it. Confess, forsake, and shake that junk off. And when it's off, you don't bring it up again. I didn't say hide it, suppress it. Suppression is not dealing. Don't give me, well, I remember when. No, you have not forgiven. You have not forgiven. That means you have suppressed anger, suppressed hurts. You're lying, you're scheming, and you're not dealing with it. And you become a hypocrite. You become a living lie. A singing, preaching, teaching, witnessing lie. You save others while you yourself are not saved. Let the rains begin. Reign in our hearts, in our minds, in our souls, in our spirit. Reign on us, Lord. It's time out for the fake and phony facade. It's time out for wearing the masquerade. Come on, let's take that junk off and let's just be holy. Let's just be what we're supposed to be. Let's just live it like we ought to live it. Oh, no. When I saw suppressing anger, did not deal with it, I got all that junk up. I got it all out. Poured my heart out, cried until I could be healed. And when I was healed, I knew it. Because when I thought, it wasn't there no more. And when I looked for it, I couldn't feel it no more. You will know when you are healed, because when the subject of your tenderness is talked about, you'll know whether you're healed. Just bring up the name, or bring up a time, or bring up a subject. You'll know you're healed just by talking that thing out. Because if you say, yeah, baby, and that turn, you turn that lip down and cock them eyes and go to rolling that head and that neck, and you go to, you ain't healed. You ain't healed. But when you're healed, you say, ah, that ain't nothing. That ain't nothing. That really ain't nothing, you know? That's not nothing. Your future is everything. Take your sister and brother by the hand and say, be angry. But sin
not. Tell him your future is more important than your anger. Come on, tell him again, your future is more important than your anger. Get somebody else and say, hey, your future is more important than your anger. Come on, look at them and say, let's deal, let's deal, let's deal, let's deal with that.